Hello there, and welcome back to my intermediate chess course. Now, I hope you've had a chance to watch the previous videos. If not, just go back and watch them. Last week, we were focusing a little bit on focused attacks and how to take advantage of undefended pieces. So identifying those pieces and then finding ways to attack them. And then perhaps using tactics to be able to win material or win points, as we say, okay? This week, I will start again with a puzzle, and then we'll go on to something which I would like to discuss a little bit more in depth. I'll tell you in a second what we're going to do. Let's start off, though, with this puzzle. Now, we're playing as black in this position, and it looks as though black can, black is winning, but will probably suffer material loss after this move. So it looks as though we're going to end up drawing the game, because if we take this knight, then, white will just take our rook. So that's no good, unfortunately. We need something a bit better than that. Your job is to try to work out a way for black to win this game. So you can set this up on your board if you want. I think it's probably best if you do that, because it means you can visualize things more easily. Especially for an actual game as well. So pause the video and see if you can come up with black's winning move in this game. Okay, it's an interesting one, isn't it? Because I think black will win if they can rescue the rook. So, but there's something even better than that. Notice that actually white's knight doesn't have too many escape squares. It's got, okay, well, it can't go off the board. It can't go here or here, because notice the king is covering those two squares. So its only remaining escape squares are these two. So I think that'll give you a big clue. Where can we put the rook where we can cover those two squares? Well, we just put the rook here. And notice that wherever white moves the knight, well, it's going to get captured. And again, I don't think black can really hope to draw this game, because now black can just move the rook across and get the knight. And that actually demonstrates the weakness of a knight at the side of the board, doesn't it? Imagine having a knight in the center. You've got 8 different possibilities. At the side, only 4. In the corner, only 2. And this is the problem. The knight here cannot go off the board. So it's limited to perhaps half its power. And that's the reason why we are able to win the knight easily. If you're an intermediate player, I believe that you should be able to checkmate with a king and rook against a king. If you're not sure how to do that, you can refer back to my catch-up lesson, which I think you have access to. Or equally good would be to go on to the Lee Chess video page here. So look under watch and then watch video library, and look under end games under king and rook against king. Anyway, I thought I'd discuss something now with you guys. In chess, we have 3 parts of the game. We have the opening, the middle game, and the end game. Now, I think at intermediate level, at the level that you guys are at, the opening is particularly important. Because if you can get a good start in the game, then that will put your opponent under pressure. And they are more likely than you to make a mistake. So I think there's probably a few things I'd like to mention before we look at a specific game on this theme. Imagine that you had 10 moves at the beginning of the game, and your opponent wasn't allowed to make any, okay? Now, you could go for something like scholar's mate, and the four move checkmate, or something similar to that, obviously. But if you weren't allowed to do that, how would you make use of your 10 moves? Have a think about that now. Maybe set the board up as you would normally, and play 10 moves that you'd like to on that board. Okay, I would imagine you've chosen something like this. You would maybe get these pawns forward, get these knights out, get these bishops out, and then perhaps castle, and then maybe you again gain a couple of more moves with these pawns, something like that. And you would maybe get the rooks and the queen out. I'm not going to overcomplicate with there's far too many arrows already on here, so I'm going to just let you think about where you put the queen and rooks. But most likely they would go in the middle, towards the center of the board, like this, once these pieces have been cleared out of the way. So that's something we want to bear in mind. We want to, first of all, control the center. Now that's something that I know that you guys are very aware of already, but it's surprising, even in quite higher level games, how many people forget to actually do this properly. You imagine the center of the board is like a magnet or something like that. The stronger the magnet, the more powerful your pieces are. So imagine this magnet is particularly strong. If we trace all the way around the center, then this is also a strong area of the board. But it becomes gradually weaker. And as we go further out, then it becomes weaker still for most pieces. So, but really it's those four squares here that we want to try to aim at. So it's kind of all about, development as well. So you want to try to make sure that all of your pieces are playing. So not just your knights, for example, not just your pawns, but also your bishops. And then after that, you want to make sure your major pieces, your queen and your rooks, are well positioned. So apart from those two sort of more obvious themes, can you think of any other important parts to the opening? What do you think you should bear in mind during the opening phase? Pause the video and perhaps write down a couple of thoughts. Okay, I think there's perhaps three more things that we could consider. Number one is time. So imagine that, for example, on this board, let's say that I did this move and Black is just passing time, not really doing anything at all, just going back and forth, doing nothing at all. Well, we've gained already so much time. We've gained time in getting our pieces out. We're already well positioned with our knights and we're controlling the center. So you can say that these knight moves that Black has done have been a complete waste of time. There's no point doing this kind of thing because you want to use different pieces all the time. If you move a piece more than once in the opening, then I would say it's got to be for a very good reason. I'll give you another example of a waste of time. Let's say, for example, that we have a normal opening like this. And on the third move, let's say white moves like this. And then, I don't know, maybe Black does something very similar. And then white decides, hang on a second, I've decided I'm going to change my mind. I'm going to move my bishop again from there to there. Well, there's nothing wrong with that as a move because it's still a good move. But notice that you've done two moves instead of one there. You didn't need to have two moves with the bishop. You could have just brought the bishop out in one move. So that's an example of wasting time in the opening. And against a stronger player, you'll find that that is a criminal offense in chess. You don't want to waste time in the opening. So I think that's probably a good example. I would also say it's something that you may not be that aware of. When you're aiming for the center, when you're developing your pieces, you're gaining space. And if you consider the board as a whole, if you've got more space than your opponent, then it's going to be a lot easier for you to maneuver your pieces into better positions. So imagine a big bus, all right, a big London bus. And okay, it might be quite busy in rush hour, but it's still generally a bit of space. If we compare that to perhaps the same number of people trying to get onto a minibus, maybe like your school money, if you've got a school minibus or maybe a van or something like that. Imagine everyone in rush hour rushing onto a small minibus. It's going to be pretty uncomfortable. And you can think of it like that in chess. You don't really want to have too many pieces in a small space. So the reason why we move these pawns in particular and why we get our pieces out quickly is so that we can take advantage of the fact that our opponent isn't really challenging our area of the board yet. Because at the moment, well, there's no pieces here can really come and affect our development that much. Okay, so it's important to grab space whilst we still can. Okay, and perhaps just one more thing, it's important really to be ready for any kind of attack. So I think the most important thing there is to castle once we've got our pieces out. It's important to be ready for an opponent's attack. Imagine like in a big battle, on a big battlefield, you want to be ready for the enemy soldiers to attack you, and your army needs to be prepared for that. Okay, so you have a certain number of moves at the beginning of the game to make sure that you are prepared. Okay, right. Just for the next part of the lesson, I wanted to show you a game from the World Championship of 1969. So we're already talking over 50 years ago, but this is still very relevant because a lot of the opening moves in these games, they don't really change because we know the importance of these factors that we've already discussed. So I'm going to show you a game, which is the 20th game of this World Championship between Petrosian, Tigran Petrosian, who was, I think he was the world champion at the time, and Boris Spassky. These are both Soviet grandmasters. So we're looking at this move, first of all. Petrosian is white. And this move here, well, we're controlling that square, controlling the d5 square. This is a bit unusual as an opening, but it's still very good. It's called the English opening. You can look that up on the watch function up here, okay, on the video library. Spassky plays this, okay? So he's thinking perhaps again about challenging this square, bringing out the bishop, something like this, maybe one of these two moves. We go into, again, a central pawn attack. So c4 and d4, these two pawns work well together because notice we've gained space, okay? We've moved these up. We're gaining control of these four squares, at least to some extent. And that's why it's such a, this is such a popular opening. D5, again, Spassky getting a pawn into the center, very important. I'm not going to heavily explain these moves. Because I think they're fairly straightforward. We're just developing here. We're not trying to attack, we're just developing. So at the moment, neither side has really committed that much. It's just a case of making sure all the pieces are coming out. So notice that Petrosian white uses the knights first. Spassky has decided to do a knight and a bishop, but again, they're both minor pieces. We're not bringing out the queen or anything. Not necessary at the moment. Bishop g5. Okay, so now Spassky decides to castle again, being ready for any enemy attack. That's what we discussed earlier. We have this move now thinking about this bishop. So we've done our two knights and this bishop here, but we're now thinking about perhaps developing this one, okay? So I'd say this next move by Spassky is the exception to our rule because I think Spassky could simply develop the knight. Something like that, or maybe get the bishop out via this direction, or maybe even just support center with a pawn, or even be more aggressive, attack this way. That would be perfectly good. These are all good moves, by the way. But I think there's a move here that Spassky plays, which is this. And you can play moves such as this when your opponent tries to attack this knight and often and this area of the board, the king's side. You can try to kick the bishop away. That's actually okay. Notice that later your king will have somewhere to run to just in case there's any attack on the back rank. So that's always a useful move to make. It's called Luft. Again, another German word. There's lots of German words in chess. We call it Luft, which means air, I believe. Gives the king some air to breathe. So I think we could bring the bishop back. Nothing wrong with that. Petrosian decides in the end to do this move. Now, ordinarily, I think you probably wouldn't give up a bishop for a knight. Think of a bishop like maybe 3.25 points compared to 3 for a knight. But in this situation, consider what that knight represented. Well, it's defending. It's defending this pawn. It's also controlling a second square in the center. Okay, so this knight has a lot of eyes looking towards the center. So getting rid of it is perhaps not a bad thing, because it means that white's control of the center increases. Okay, so I'm going to show you another, just another few moves. After this, we're looking now to develop again. So we're not, again, we're not attacking, just developing. We could move this bishop out. But here's a nice little point that I think it's worth discussing. I mentioned earlier about time in the opening. And if you can avoid moving something more than once, then that's probably good. If a piece moves twice in the opening, then we're kind of wasting time. So for example, if Petrosian played this move, which is perfectly good, by the way, he's moved his bishop, but Spassky could do this. Now notice then that our bishop is under attack. We can't leave it there. We have to do something about it. It's a threat. So, well, this is the best move. We just take. But notice we've now moved our bishop twice, once to d3 and once to c4. So that means that black in some way has gained a little bit of time. It means that black can perhaps spend an extra move attacking the center, or maybe just simply developing, something like this. This would be okay. Compare that to, let's say that we just bided our time. I'm just going to show you what might have happened. I think in the game, yes, in the game it was this move. So we're delaying the bishop move just by one or two moves, because we want to avoid losing time. A move such as this is fine, because we're putting the queen somewhere pretty safe. Imagine the queen like a spider controlling lots of different, or protecting lots of different pieces around our army. It's like the bus conductor. And now if we compare that to a move here, we could do pawn takes pawn for black, but then we would only need one move with this bishop. We wouldn't need to move it twice, but only once. So that's actually quite an interesting point. We could play the bishop out immediately, but Petrosian decides just to wait an extra move, and in the hope that black will play this move, okay? In fact, he doesn't. He plays this, which is simply to allow the bishop to come out, maybe even to this square, but I think more likely to go to here. The bishop goes there for what's called a fianchetto, and it controls the center from a distance. Okay, I'm just going to show you what happens next. Now, Petrosian doesn't really want to delay castling much longer. Note that black has already castled a while ago, and there's always a risk if you leave your king in the center, then that's always going to be potentially a target for your opponent. So what he does, if you want to pause the video now, see if you can work out a way of resolving the problem with this bishop. And what would you do? Pause the video. Well, actually, I think this is quite a clever move. Pawn takes pawn. Because then we don't have to worry about black taking our pawn and then forcing us to waste a move. So black just takes back. Obviously, we can't take with the queen because of the knight. Have to take with the pawn. And then, well, on the next, I think it's not immediately, but in the next couple of moves, white does play this, okay? So I think that is a really nice game in terms of just working out where the pieces go initially, but also considering the ideas of time, space, and also not wasting either of those. So not wasting time. I'm going to unshare now. I think that should be quite a valuable game. And you can look this up again if you want online or on, I think it's called chessgames.com. Just to repeat, the game was Petrosian Spassky from Moscow 1969. Okay, so if you want to look up the remainder of the game, then you can, and that's definitely a good thing to do. So hopefully that was useful to you. Remember, time, space, and not attacking, but just developing in the opening. Okay, remember those first 10 moves are vital to the success of your plan. Okay, hope you enjoyed that, and see you next week.